Hey everyone, Caroline here. And will you take a look at that map? You've seen quite a few maps up to this point, and so I'm pretty sure that you get what I'm talking about. That's right, mountains, mountains, and more mountains. So the big question is, how did Europe come to have all of these mountain ranges? And to break it down, what are the major mountain ranges of Europe? And while we're at it, let's also fill you in on a few of their characteristics so that you can keep those in mind as you study the rest of Europe. Shall we? And so first, how did Europe come to have all of these mountain ranges? Well, let's start by introducing yet another geographic term, and that's orogeny. I know, right? Weird. Let me explain. Orogeny is the creation of mountain ranges from tectonic plates of the earth smashing into each other, hockey style. But unlike the WWE, which only creates more pay-per-view specials, these incomprehensibly massive forces created the most stunning ranges on our planet today, including the Himalayas of South Asia. Bringing it back to our study of Europe, the collision of the African, Eurasian, and Arabian plates created much of the Alps, the Caucasus, and the Balkan Mountains as well, which we'll talk more about today. But that isn't the total story. As we've already discussed, our friends, the glaciers, have carved out multiple mountainous and hilly regions across Central and Northern Europe, adding to the already rough topography of the continent. Last, and related to, and yet so very different from tectonic forces, is volcanism. And perhaps surprisingly to some, Europe is known for its volcanoes. Making a rough line near the Mediterranean Sea as a result of the African plate pushing against the massive Eurasian plate, there are many, many volcanic features. So let's highlight four here. At 18,510 feet, Mount Elbrus is the tallest mountain in Europe, one of the seven summits of the world. Its last eruption was about 50 CE, but as it's grown to over 18,000 feet, it probably won't be the last. Off the southern coast of Italy, on the island of Sicily, Mount Etna is one of Europe's most active volcanoes, with frequent eruptions, the most recent of which was June of 2021. The famous, or should I say infamous one, that most of us know about, Vesuvius, located in western Italy, is the volcano responsible for the destruction of the Roman resort towns of Pompeii and Herculaneum in 79 CE. And just north of Sicily, the island of Volcano has four active calderas and is the origin of the word we use for all volcanoes today. See? And one of the homes of mythical Vulcan, the armorer of the Roman gods. So now that we know how these mountains were created, let's run through some of the most important mountain chains on the European continent. Also called Skanderna, the Scandinavian mountains run 1,100 miles down the western side of the Scandinavian peninsula, dropping sharply into the North and Norwegian seas and giving Norway its picturesque fjords. While not high, in fact, the highest peak is Galopiggen at 8,100 feet, the mountains can be extremely steep-sided, mostly carved through glaciation. Those glaciers, I tell ya. The climate of Skanderna is mostly permafrost, but on the eastern side of the mountains are much of the birch forests and grasslands of Scandinavia, with a widely varied set of biomes, from tundra down to temperate areas of coniferous forests and bogs. This unique area has been designated as in need of protection by the World Wildlife Fund. Taking their name from the Latin alfito, meaning white flower, probably in reference to their snow-capped peaks, the Alps are the highest and most extensive mountain range entirely within the main European peninsula. Running 750 miles and spanning 8 countries, the Alps are generally divided into 3 major sections: Western, Central, and Eastern. The Western Alps are sometimes also called the Maritime Alps, as they seem to rise straight out of the Mediterranean Sea on the border of northeast Italy and southern France. The highest section of these mountains, the Central Alps, contain the highest peak in the range, Mont Blanc, at 15,778 feet, and among the most picturesque, such as the iconic Matterhorn. The Eastern Alps fall between the Rhine and Danube rivers and run along the borders of Germany and Austria. This section is also called the Bavarian Alps. Forming the border between France and Spain, and as a great example of a geographic boundary, also forming the border between the Iberian Peninsula and the rest of continental Europe. The Pyrenees Mountains only reach 11,000 feet at their highest. The mountain range is also known for the high mountain passes, the lowest of which is Col de la Perche, is over 5,100 feet in elevation. The Pyrenees do not possess many lakes, as glaciation was not a huge feature in their formation. But most years, in the spring, the snow will melt and create torrential rivers called Gaves, some of which have waterfalls over 1,000 feet high. Whew. The Apennines are actually 3 distinct sets of ranges: the northern, central, and southern Apennines, which together run nearly the length of the Italian peninsula, meeting up with the Alps to the north and through the toe section of Italy's boot to the south. To the west of the north and central chain, you'll notice a relatively large, flat area today, taking in the districts of Tuscany, Lazio, and Campania. This area is notable as not only the birthplace of the city of Rome on the banks of the Tiber River, but is also a major agrarian center for Italy even today. Sometimes considered an extension of the Alps, the Carpathian Mountains run for 932 miles in a large semicircle, traveling through 8 countries and taking up almost 50% of the country of Romania. So, we talked about tectonic activity before, but it's not always bad news. The Carpathian Mountains are full of hot mineral springs, or springs heated by magma deep beneath the surface of the earth. In fact, 1/3 of all hot springs in Europe can be found in Romania. Now that's volcanism I can get behind. As with almost all other mountains that we've talked about, the Carpathians have different names depending upon the region. The most famous of these regions in the Carpathians, the Transylvanian Plateau, is home to the legendary vampire Dracula. At least, according to the author, Bram Stoker. Running east to west from the Caspian Sea to the Black Sea and forming the traditional border between Europe and Southwest Asia, the Caucasus Mountains are the home of the tallest mountain in Europe, the volcano Mount Elbrus. Because of the deep valleys and tall peaks, multiple cultures and traditions have flourished in this area. Have you ever heard of the jinn? You probably know them as genies. Well, legend has it, they come from a mountain somewhere in the Caucasus, known as Mount Kaf. Additionally, Zoroastrianism, a monotheistic religion founded in Iran, includes a legend that Arianim Vaja, one of the 16 perfect lands of the world, also existed here. From a Bulgarian word meaning high or proud, the Balkan Mountains stretch 350 miles and lends its name to the peninsula also known as Southeast Europe. The Balkans are home to diverse flora and fauna, much of it to be found nowhere else in Europe, including the Eurasian brown bear and Eurasian wolf. Unlike the Pyrenees, the Balkans have multiple low passes through, and where you have a way through the mountains, you've got people. Many cities are found near Balkan mountain passes, including Sofia, the capital city of Bulgaria. Last but not least, the longest mountain range in Europe runs 1,600 miles from the Arctic Ocean to the Kazakh steppe and traditionally marks the boundary between Europe and Asia. Yep, we're talking about the Ural Mountains. The Urals aren't the largest mountains in the world, as the highest peak is only about 6,000 feet above sea level, but they are full of mineral wealth, with over 1,000 types of different minerals present. In fact, the majority of Russia's mining operations and profits have come from the Urals for the last 200 years. Interestingly, due to the heavy mining of certain areas, the Urals also have 9 separate nature preserves in order to protect some of the Ural ecosystem for the future. As you may have guessed, being so far inland and relatively low, the Urals have a mostly continental climate with warmer summers and colder winters. See, we could have made you walk all this way, but we thought it was better to show you just a few of the many, many mountains of the European continent. Not only the source of mineral wealth and multiple rivers, as we learned in our lesson on European rivers, but also a place for exploring, learning, and maybe a little skiing. So, that's our overview of the physical features and regions of Europe. And as we continue our exploration, we're going to look into the particulars of Europe's people, cultures, economics, and government. Pretty exciting stuff. So keep your binoculars, notepad, and walking shoes handy and join us as we keep exploring. Hey, hey.